Well, it's 7:02, so why don't we get the meeting started?
Indeed.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome you all here today where we meet to improve lives locally and globally. I am the president, I'm Barb Buckley, and of the most fun and awesome Rotary Club of North St. Paul, Maplewood, and Oakdale. Ray Hosh, would you recite the Pledge of Allegiance?
Sure. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Ray. Randy Comfort, would you lead us in the... 5-way test.
I sure will. So this is the test of the things we think, say, or do. Number one, is it the truth? Number two, is it fair to all concerned? Number three, will it build goodwill and better friendships? Number four, will it be beneficial to all concerned? And number five, is it fun?
Yay. Thank you, Randy. Kind of our honoring Veterans Day coming up this Wednesday, I'm going to have Sean show a video, YouTube video of the military medley salute for Veterans Day. So we're going to play a few songs here.
Trail, and we'll take on the glory of God.
Thank you, Barb.
Yep, thank you, Barb.
Well, you're welcome, and thank you, Sean, for being able to do all of this. And now I'd like to just quick take a little change in order here. Would the people who served in the military or veterans here, would you raise your hand? Okay, well, actually, we kind of maybe go around the room here. Roger, could you come off mute and say what branch of service you're in and what years you served?
If I can come off mute here.
Yep.
Yep.
You can hear me?
Yep, yes. I can hear you.
Okay, I served in the Army in Europe and the Middle East.
Okay, and what years did you serve?
57 to 59. It's been a while.
Okay, thank you, Roger. Bruce?
I served in the Air Force and in the Air National Guard from 1968 until 1975.
Okay.
For our side.
Well, I hope so. Brandy. Brandy, yes, Greenlee.
Yeah, I served in the Navy from 17 to 21. That was from 64 to 67. And I did my at-sea time on the USS Kuishewi, which is a ship that's named after the Kuishewi River in northern Minnesota.
Thank you.
Randy, at first I thought you meant 1917 and 1921.
Right. Yeah.
We got it. That was your age.
Yeah. World War One. It was a tough slog, but we did it.
World War One.
I really need to get with my father-in-law because he's in the same years from the Navy too. Hopefully one of these days when the pandemic is over and go shooting.
Okay. Randy Comfort, did you have your hand up? Oh, maybe it was something else. Mo, did you serve?
No, I did not.
You did not. Was there other hands out here that I missed somebody? Okay. Well, I know I and the club appreciate your service and all that you've done for our country. So thank you very much for doing that.
Thank you for your service, all of you.
Yeah,
you're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Rick Pratt, would you lead us in an invocation or words of encouragement?
All right. I think Sean's got a, there we go. I'll just say that in 5 days, it'll be Veterans Day, a day to honor the service of the women and the men who have worn the uniforms of the Armed Forces of the United States of America. So this morning, I offer this prayer for veterans. Proud of our nation, they answered her call, defending the freedom and safety of all, on land, or on sea, or in plains high above, they went out of duty and honor and love. However they served, Lord, wherever they went, bless them and help them to know what it meant. And Lord, help us to thank them on Veterans Day, because we owe them far more than we could ever say. Amen.
Thank you, Rick. Randy Greiling, do you have a Friday morning wake-up quiz question?
I do. This morning's quiz question, we're after a person, place, thing, or event. As soon as you think you know the answer, yell it out loud enough that I can hear it.
I'm mute.
Pardon?
Everybody.
I am unmuted.
No, I meant everybody else. There we go. Oh, okay.
Unplug.
Okay, here we go. I sound like Mickey's girlfriend's soda. I am cool. Vikings come after me.
Minnesota.
I have
Minnesota.
More
Minnesota.
Yes. Minnesota.
Minnesota. Minnesota is correct.
Minnesota. I've heard of it.
Awesome.
Well, Minnesota.
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 Okay, what are his
girlfriend's
yeah.
cola? Minnesota.
Okay, what are Sergeants at Arms, Randy, Joe, and Myra, introduce our guest and happy bucks.
Good. Good morning, everyone. Hi, Joe. Hi, Randy.
Good morning.
Good morning, Myra. Good morning, everyone. Looks like we have our guest, Mindy, is here with us today.
Yes.
Good morning, Mindy.
Hi, Mindy.
Good morning.
Thanks for
joining. Have you ever come across a group this cheerful at 7 a.m. on a Friday?
Not since I was a Rotary member myself.
All right. What club did you belong to?
The one in Roseville. And they had two at that time. One was the noontime one, but the one I belonged to was 7:07. It started at, they prided themselves on starting on the dot at 7 minutes after seven.
Perfect. Roseville was one of our founding clubs for our club.
Oh.
Back in 79.
Hmm. Yeah.
Hmm. Cool.
Well, Mo was there.
Yeah, Mo was there. Really?
Wow.
If we started at 7:07 when we are in person, does that mean there's less late fines?
I don't know. Always there. I didn't want to find out.
You know, during my presidency, I think we started right around 7:07 because my daycare didn't open until 7, so I could drop the kids off, and I had about 5 minutes to get to the meeting. So we always started a little late, but it wasn't as precise as 7:07. That's for sure.
How's everybody doing this week? Any things to announce? Any happy bucks? Any things on people's minds that they're excited to share?
I'd like to offer happy bucks. I'm going to put in 10 bucks because yesterday when we were at Wild Wings hunting, Randy announced that he no longer uses a flip phone.
Oh.
So I'm putting in 10 bucks because now Randy has a smartphone.
Oh, wow.
And so far, I've gotten 3 calls on it, but they're all from people trying to upgrade my automobile warranty.
I could close.
And of course, even though I had it, I forgot to take it with me when I left, so I didn't have it yesterday.
Oh. Hard to fix that one.
Still sitting on the kitchen table.
I guess
the phone number is on the club's website. It's been updated, my personal information.
Oh, it's been updated. Okay. So now I can text you, huh?
Text,
well,
email,
yeah, you can everything. Try and see if I get it.
He even knows how to take pictures with it.
Yeah. Angie sent me a text, and so I sent her text back. It said, me text. Because she said something about coming out of the caveman days or something like that. So I
me text.
Well, the other silver lining there is that you can do telehealth now.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe someday.
Reluctantly.
Yeah.
I can't quite see sitting here and having some doctors say, well, what's that funny thing on your back?
Hey, the best part is that, well, at least you don't do telehealth at home, because there's stories about physicians where they're asking their patients to drop their pants, and all of a sudden their kids are driving by or walking. What are you doing, Mom?
So, Randy, would that be your wife?
What?
That thing on your back, would that be your wife?
Oh, no, she's... One thing about Jeannie, she's not a nagger. I come home from Sporting Clays and she goes, "You back already?"
Randy, what, too soon?
What is your cell phone number?
It's on the website.
It's only your home phone.
No.
Your primary home line. Because I just tried to send you a text and it bounced back. I'm looking at Club Runner.
I updated the page and I put the cell phone number in there.
Okay. In other words, I don't know what
it is. I'd have to look it up.
Yeah, he has no idea.
You might not have clicked save, though. I make changes sometimes, and I forget. Save is down below the fold, and I miss it.
Yeah.
And then it doesn't actually.
I thought I did click save. How do you like my picture, Naomi?
Cute.
Thank you.
Very cute.
That really is me.
You look like a Gerber baby. Just beautiful.
Any other happy thoughts?
I have a happy buck.
Thanks, Brian.
So I'm going to throw 10 bucks in again this week. We have more donations for our shoot campaign. We received this week $1,000 from Lake Elmo Bank. We received $1,000 from Lake Area Bank. We received $500 from Premier Bank. And we received $74 from Randy Greenlee because it was his birthday, and now again he's older than I am.
Oh, yeah, we're approaching middle age now.
Yeah, right.
Happy birthday!
I got a happy
bump the thermometer. How close are we to halfway point, Sean?
Let me pull it up here. We are past the halfway point.
All right.
$1,500.
All right.
Okay.
Nice.
So we got till June 30th to get the other half. So.
Yep.
December.
So I'm getting into a routine. I got a happy find. My routine is my daughter comes over, drops off little Arlene and Clarky, 4 and 2. And then my son drops off Maxwell Bruce. And then I have him solo for most of the day. And then every Friday we've been doing this. And a lot of times I stay overnight. So
you don't need to go to the gym on Fridays then.
Oh, no. They push me down the hills in the bag. They do all sorts of stuff. But so I'll put in the happy find. And then, Randy, call me on your new iPhone after the meeting, because I had a closing this week. I couldn't follow up with those other two banks, but I will on my
Okay.
All right. Yeah, call me after the meeting.
Yeah, you got a nice sledding hill down to the green down there for the kids in the wintertime, don't you?
Yeah, now I have a huge pond, too.
You also got a huge tree right in the middle at the bottom, so you got to kind of put some deflectors up for that.
Yeah, my neighbors and I got together. We're building an ark.
Go ahead, Barb.
Okay, well, in honor of my father, I will donate $95, that's his age, to our fundraising. This is he was a veteran of World War II, and so I took him on the honor flight.
Cool.
He was one of the younger ones, so he was on the boat going over to fight in Europe, and that got called off. And then he was sent to the Marshall Islands.
Oh.
And then he was supposed to be the first wave of attacking Japan. And then since the bombs were dropped, that was called off. And then he ended up over in Korea for a little while, driving around generals and meeting with the Russians. Oh. So, but he's still living. So,
wow,
94, nice.
That's 95. So
milking cows was good for him. good to him.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And he was also born in the Netherlands, so he came over when he was 5.
Wow.
Wow.
What a history.
Yeah.
That was.
Yep. So.
I also just contributed some happy bucks for my father, who served in Korea or in the Korean conflict. He was actually stationed in Okinawa during that time. And his claim to fame was he learned how to drive everything that the army had at that time. He built flat surfaces for building runways for airplanes for various places they were headed to all over the Pacific theater. So I put in some money for that. And in tying that together also with next Wednesday being our flag placing day for Veterans Day on Wednesday, our final one of the year. So
Randy, what branch did you say he was in?
He was in the Army.
In the Army. Okay.
Yep. Yeah. He was served in the Army during the years of Korea. He was never actively in Korea, but he was nearby. And like I said, in Okinawa.
So Randy, was he an Army engineer?
Yeah, he was. Yes, he was. But he just happened to have, he grew up on a farm and he happened to know how to drive everything they had. So he kind of landed a job on every place he went of driving big machinery, like the grading or the dump truck stuff, the really big earth mover stuff. But he became kind of an expert of navigating that grader. Later went on to a career in Lockheed, tracking satellites, orbits of satellites. And just a quick thing to share. Actually, I have it in my office here. He was sent to Johnson Space Center in Houston as a consultant for NASA for the first space shuttle flights. And basically making sure that NASA knew where the Lockheed products were and where the communication, the trajectory of those satellites were. So I have an honorary mug of his that actually says Columbia as he was there. And he was assigned in mission control to the orbits department. So that's what I have here in my office as a commemorative thing of him.
Nice.
Very cool.
I have one more happy find too. Randy, my dad served on the Lexington.
Ah.
Let's see if I can get a picture up. There's him on the back of the ship.
Oh, beautiful, nice.
Some missile
launchers. It's a gun show.
Yeah, with the gun shells, but his job was parking airplanes, you know, and they would start pushing it, and he'd always hit the brakes, he said, and they'd get mad at him because he thought he was going over the edge. But, yeah, he was on the one that was there when they kind of liberated the prisoners from Japan.
Oh.
Wow.
I have a happy buck for today. I have a couple things to catch up on. So my oldest son got married about a month ago.
Whoa.
Hey, congrats.
Woo-hoo. Thank you. Turned out to be a beautiful day. All things COVID, lots of stress before, but the day of was perfect. So super blessed for that. And found out my Marine gets to come home for Christmas. So
great.
Super excited for that. Yeah. Yeah, and we added a second Marine. One of the cousins in the family became a Marine a couple of weeks ago. So now we have two.
Wonderful.
That's very cool.
So, yeah. My last one, I have one more. So for my clinic, I wrote a pretty large grant that we had received before, but this is the most we'd ever asked for. We found out last week that we did receive the grant. It's for almost $200,000 a year for 5 years.
Awesome.
Wow. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Wow.
I will throw money in for those.
If you could see, there's my yearbook Navy picture from 1967.
So handsome.
Wow. You are a hottie.
Still is.
Oh, yes, yeah. You are a hottie.
You haven't lost it, Randy. Haven't lost it.
Thank you.
Should be a baby picture.
You are kind of a hunk. Not that.
Well, I want to put a
hat. I got nothing to say to that.
No, it's fun listening to all your stories. Thank you to the people that served. I really We all appreciate that. But I want to put out happy buck. I'm so excited to have Mindy Greiling join us at the Rotary. We go back a long ways. I grew up in Roseville, and my little sister and her daughter were good friends, and I actually was one of their babysitters for the kids. And so, but we go a long ways, and as a member of the Women League of Voters, I heard about Mindy's new book, and I had the opportunity to hear about her, and she has a remarkable resume, and I hope you all get to meet her, and maybe that'll be part of your introduction also, Mindy, but super, super excited to have you and see you again and hear your important story of your journey with your son. Yes, Jim.
Thank you, Rochelle. We always called the Mentos first. They had three babysitters, so we took them anyway. And each was as good as the other one.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
So I'll put some happy bucks for that, so that I'm excited.
Thank you. Well, thanks for joining us today, Mindy.
Thank you. Thank you. It's fun to be here in this great sense of community.
Yes.
Which we don't get enough of anymore.
Right.
True.
Are there any other happy bucks to share? If not, we'll turn it back over to President Barb.
Okay, thank you. No birthdays this week. And we already talked about the flag placement on, it's the last one, and that is on Wednesday, November 11th. And I'd like to thank all of our flag placers for all their hard work during this year. Much appreciated, and the funds we raised from that is fantastic. This month is Rotary Foundation Month, so we'll probably be hearing a little bit more about that during the month. That's all I had for announcements, unless somebody else had one. Okay, well then we'll get on to our guest speaker today, Mindy Greiling, and I'll let you just kind of take it away, Mindy.
All right. Thank you, Barb. And thank you to Rochelle again for inviting me. I really appreciate the chance to be here. And I think I overdressed because when I used to go to Rotary, everybody had on suits and business outfits. And so I still have my jeans on, of course, but I put on a blouse and I see most of you are much more comfortable. So I think Rotary's taking a turn for the better in this regard. If you're out of your pajamas, you get a point for that. That is really good. So I'm going to put up a PowerPoint, and then I will start once I get this up. And let's see, double click, and then. Okay, there we go. All right. I wrote this book after I left the legislature. I was really pleased while I was there to be able to work on the mental health system. But once I left, then I found I didn't have as good of a chance for advocating on a larger level than just personal. So I joined the Loft Literary Center, took classes, and wrote this memoir. It took me a long time. When our son first got sick with schizophrenia, which was a good 20 years ago, I was lucky to be in the Minnesota House of Representatives. And so unlike other people who wonder, what can we do? I actually had a seat at the table and got to do a lot at the legislature. Like I said, I took the classes at the Loft, and there we learned that stories are the fastest path to empathy. So that's what I wanted. My main goal for this book is empathy for people dealing with serious mental illness and their families. And then once people have empathy, they will want to go to action to make things better. So I worked with my son on this book, Jim, and sometimes people with especially serious mental illness don't want their families telling their story. And so it was very important to me that Jim be willing to have his story told, because of course it's my story. Mental illness affects the whole family, but it's of course his story. And I decided to get his buy-in right away. And I was glad that he did. He helped me edit the book, read all the chapters, and was very helpful. And for those of you who might read the book, I just want to say here, he's doing so much better than he did during a good share of the book. When he was first getting sick, we didn't notice it because he was using marijuana and other drugs when he was in high school. So that kind of blurred the picture of the budding mental illness. But here, he's about 20, and he still looks healthy, even though he'd been having struggles for quite a few years. But notice him here, and then I'll go to 1 year later when he was getting visibly sick. And you can see he's thinner, looks more serious. Look at his fist is kind of tense around his sister. So I go back and you can just see the stark difference. But since it happened gradually, we did not notice really that he was getting sick like this until he called. He was out in Montana at the University of Montana, and he called and told me that the women in the apartment next door were talking about him. He could hear them through the walls. That reminded me of my grandmother who had schizophrenia. And I thought, no, he couldn't possibly be getting what she had. He didn't present like she did, even though she did very well a lot of the time. But she was in the Rochester State Hospital for quite a few years. So that worried me. And especially when he was in the psych ward for the first time, he really had some bizarre ideas. And so I'm going to read just one passage from the book. At this point, and Jim was in the psych ward, we had had to call the police because he got quite out of control. So he starts out here when I visited him at United Hospital. Why'd you call the police? I took a gulp of air to keep you safe, to get you medical care. I'm not sick. He pursed his lips and blew air at me as if he were exhaling cigarette smoke. Then he spit into a nearby wastebasket, his ways of purging me. They're torturing me here. No, they're not, honey. He glanced at me. And you're not my real mom, are you? I blinked back tears. You aren't my real son either, I shouted in my head. I should have married my soulmate. Then none of this would have happened. Jim loudly interrupted my silent shouting. And I'd be the new devil. He stared balefully at me for a long second and then stomped off. My throat swelled shut and I gasped to breathe. This was the first I'd heard of any of this. So you can see bizarre notions. But then he got on medication and anybody, which I'm guessing quite a few people here today have dealt with mental illness because it's common. There's 50,000 people in Minnesota with schizophrenia alone, not counting other illnesses. But Jim got on medication and he did quite well. And so here he is. He came to me to a House of Representatives reception. And here he is sitting in my chair looking normal, even though just a few months before was that scene where he thought he was the new devil. People wonder why people don't stay on their medications. One reason is weight gain. When you take antipsychotics, you are definitely going to gain weight if you're almost everybody. And so here you can see Jim is starting to gain weight. He had a flat belly just a couple months before. Until he started psych meds. He had been an emaciated 170 pounds, but by the time he'd been on psych meds for a couple of years, he was at 218 pounds, and he was actually still gaining until he got allergic to those meds and had to go off of them. And then he shrunk back to his normal size, but he also had trouble with his his thoughts again, because the meds that gain, that cause you to gain weight, actually some of them are the better meds mentally speaking, but not with all that weight gain. As I said, mental illness affects the whole family. So here's our daughter, Angela, who was Rochelle's youngest sister's good friend. And Rochelle was in her wedding too. She's talking to Paul Wellstone, late Senator Paul Wellstone, who is the first person she told about Jim's mental illness. She's here. She was a reporter at that time for the Rochester Post-Bulletin in Washington, D.C. Here's the whole family that mental illness affects. And Jim is doing really well in this picture. He's in the back center. But there always is a chasm between people who have serious mental illness and their family. So Angela's a superstar. Here she is when she was covering the White House, flew into St. Paul. Here's the Union Station for a press conference with Obama. And she flew in with him on Air Force One. So there's definitely a fine line, quite a line for parents and others to traverse when you're dealing with children who have different outcomes in life. When I left the legislature, I was told my colleagues, be sure to work on the mental health system after I leave as well. And they actually did. We got a lot of things done when I was there. A lot of things have been done to improve the mental health system since, although it's got a long ways to go. Here's Jim when he's definitely, I wouldn't say the worst for wear, but he's had a lot of wear. But he did, in this picture, get an apartment finally after a couple of years. He had had a lot of trouble getting an affordable apartment by the time he was about 40, because he'd had a lot of different problems with his record, financial problems. He'd had scrapes with the law, which often happens with people with serious mental illness because we don't get them help in time. So in his apartment, he put this picture up. I included it in the slideshow because it's his favorite picture of himself in Alaska camping or backpacking. And this picture, as Rochelle said, we're both in the League of Women Voters. And so I locally, after I left the legislature, have chaired, co-chaired a study on the police and how they deal with people with mental illness, and also a study on affordable housing. So even when you're no longer a legislator, all of us can advocate at the local level. And this is the final slide, because I want to leave time for questions. So I'm currently the president of NAMI Ramsey, a National Alliance on Mental Illness, which is the organization I definitely recommend that people hook up with if you're dealing with any kind of mental illness, because they have wonderful educational opportunities and chances to network with people in similar situations. And I love their shirt here, "You are not alone." And so if we were in a typical audience, I always ask at this point, if we, so I'm going to take down my slide, my screen here. I have to share. Okay. I always ask people, if you count your extended family and you count like aunts and uncles, cousins, anybody that's related to you, and you include any type of mental illness from, you know, situational depression up to things like bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, and you include substance abuse, because half of the people with mental illness have substance abuse issues, and half the people that have substance abuse issues have a mental illness, the 50% either way. So then I ask the audience, is there anyone here who does not have anyone in their family who qualifies in one of those categories. So since we're a small enough group and I can see you, is there anyone here who's escaped substance abuse or mental illness? Typical. So questions, that's my favorite part. So I rushed through my slideshow, which Rochelle knows, she's seen other programs I can take a lot longer with, but I wanted to leave time for a discussion because this is such a articulate group, and I knew you would be since I've been in the Rotary. And also I think it's appropriate with Veterans Day, because veterans often come back with PTSD and things like that.
How's your son?
Triggered by extreme trauma. It's partly hereditary, but it also can be triggered by experiences. So any questions or comments even, or anybody want to share a story?
How's your son doing?
Really well. Thanks for asking. You know, people talk about the stress of COVID-19, but for people like him, he actually doesn't see a huge difference because he does like to see people one at a time, which, now we can't have large groups like we like to do, but for him, he doesn't like large groups. He would rather see just one person at a time or maybe two. So, and he's still doing that. He has friends and he's able to work. He can only go in 2 days a week because, he's on a team and only so many can be in the office at a time. So.
Say, Mindy, did it have any concept of why it didn't show up until he was a young man? Or in retrospect, do you see that, maybe when he was in junior high, even in grade school now, there were signs that we didn't realize? It just seems weird that you could go so long and then all of a sudden this starts to show up.
Well, that's a very good question. And, actually for things like schizophrenia and bipolar disorder, they don't tend to show up until late teens or early 20s for men. And for women, it's even later, often mid to late 20s. So people can go along looking very healthy. But Jim himself noticed, he said, when he was in, when he was 11, that something was wrong. He looked in the mirror, he said, and he thought, something's not right with me. So he noticed it before we did. But, as I said, when he was in high school, he started using marijuana, I think, when he was in about ninth grade, and then tried a lot of other drugs. And we knew he was using those. So we didn't think about him having a mental illness actually till he was in college and started talking about those voices. And that reminded me of my grandmother. She had been sick and I knew that, all along, but she didn't use drugs. So it didn't seem the same at all. I mean, everybody presents differently. But actually, the first psychotic break, as they call it, or the first episode, usually does happen, in the late teens or early 20s. There are children who get schizophrenia or bipolar disorder. There's a whole movement for children's mental health, but that's much more rare.
Can it be linked to any type of, physical change in the brain that in the later years, is that what's going on, or don't they know?
Well, they are definitely doing a lot more research. And there's a lot of research that actually marijuana contributes to psychosis. They're doing that research even at the University of Minnesota and around the world, actually. But when in the 60s, when I was growing up and people were trying marijuana, it wasn't nearly as strong as it is nowadays. So there's a high link to teenagers who use marijuana to having a psychotic episode. And some people can just steer clear and have one psychotic episode, a drug-induced psychosis, they call it. But then others, they, like our son, are, then they have it for life. And, you know, Jim freely says he wishes he wouldn't have used drugs. He feels like that caused him to get sick sooner than he would have and worse, you know, that maybe he would have gotten sick anyway, because we do have it in our genes, in our family, but, and it is partly hereditary. If you have identical twins, one of them, if one of them, one in 100 persons get schizophrenia on average, but if you have identical twins, your chances are upped to 50-50 to get schizophrenia. So it's clearly linked to heredity, but not only, otherwise it would be 100, they both would get it. So it's also connected to other experiences, like it being in a stressful environment, like going off to war or using drugs. And the brain continues to develop until you're like in your mid-20s. So even the legalized recreational marijuana group, some of those advocates, who of course are older than mid-20s themselves, but they're willing to say, you know, maybe it should not be legalized for people until they're 25. You know, and so because when the brain is still developing, it's so much more susceptible to experiences like drug use or other things causing mental illness.
May I just one thought too, is that many of these people compensate because they're trying to kind of, you know, numb some of those feelings or try to settle down some of those thoughts by using some of those drugs. So it's kind of like, what comes first, the chicken or the egg?
Exactly.
Yeah. Exactly. And then I have a question too. As a mom dealing with two kids that had completely different outcomes in lives, how did you balance that? Because how do you make, you know, room for the person who has, you know, a normal outcome in life, or, you know, better than a normal outcome in life, and then you have another child that is having so much disability from his mental illness?
That's a really charged question, and it's still something we, you know, try to deal with. But I think, you know, our daughter, they often say, if somebody in the family isn't doing well, then sometimes the other one overachieves, you know, they try to compensate. And I think Rochelle could say that Angela probably was always going to be an achiever. So I'm not sure if she's overachieving, but it's definitely a factor. So when Jim was first sick, for instance, you know, we told her about what was going on with him, but I kind of soft pedaled some of it because I didn't want her to worry. She was just out of college and, you know, starting out, she was living in Washington, D.C. So we shared, you know, a great deal with her, but not everything. And then she, in turn, had surgery on her thyroid, which meant that it was eradicated, and she has to take medicine for the rest of her life for an autoimmune disease. And she didn't tell us about that. You know, we were, both sides of us were protecting the other one. So I think there's some of that stilted relationship that can happen when one is sick and one is not. But we are not really yet, I would say, you know, perfect at doing that. We try to honor what she's doing. It's kind of like on a grand scale, if you have one kid who brings home straight A's, you know, with their report card, and then you've got another one who gets B's and C's, and every parent has, you know, not every parent, but a lot of parents know that's a harder thing to do. And maybe the one that got a B had to try a lot harder than the one who got an A. So it's kind of like that on steroids when you've got one that's so sick and one that's not. But we try to say for Jim, he's a super achiever too, you know, in his own way. He's helping with this book. He's working, you know, he's sober, which is something for him.
Hey, Mindy, there's been so much advancement in DNA mapping and everything. Could this have any, I mean, you had a grandma that had it, right?
Right, yes.
And could this be a remedy for this, or have you seen anything like that? And what was it like growing up with a grandma that had it?
Well, first I'll say about the genome project, you know, looking at the DNA and all of that, that has been something that people in the mental health world, as well as others, were very excited about, thinking that would finally find the cause of schizophrenia and other illnesses. But unfortunately, it did turn out to be helpful, but they found that schizophrenia is caused by a multitude of genes. So there wasn't one to pinpoint, there were many, many. And so that just made it, there weren't any answers with that project. But there is a whole movement trying to reclassify schizophrenia and bipolar disorder as neurological brain disorders rather than mental illnesses, because there is this component of being in the genes, and then there would be much more research. There's a lot more research for Parkinson's, for instance, or Alzheimer's than there is for schizophrenia, because those are classified as neurological brain disorders. So that's a hope that, you know, if you could find the cause, all we know already, if you can find the cause of something, that's the beginning of finding the solution. But we don't know the cause for serious mental illness. And then the second part of your question, my grandmother was a great grandmother, and we just really didn't care that she heard voices. She was, she was a baker, a gardener. We lived in Rochester, so we fed the ducks. You know, we lived near Silver Lake, if you're familiar with Rochester. So it was too bad, a tragedy actually, that she had to live at the state hospital. She did get really sick when I was I was about 10 in fifth grade. So that's when she had to go to the hospital. But she took her meds and did quite well. If it were today, she would have just been there, you know, probably a matter of weeks and come right back home again. But that in those days, they didn't think that mental illness was curable. Once you were there, you stayed. And so that was a whole different world. But we still visited her, and she was still a great grandma. But we really didn't see, you know, we saw her once a week or so after that. So it totally changed our relationship. But before that, my sister and I, who was a year older than me, knew that she threw out food. You know, she thought people were poisoning her food, and she thought the radio talked to her. But we kids, you know, don't think much, you know, just thought that's her, you know. So
does it tend to skip a generation?
Well, I don't know that it really has a huge pattern, but that can happen. It obviously did for us. When I was in college, I took psychology classes for my BA and my MA, you know, minored in psychology for both of those. And so I tried to learn about it at that time. But back in those days, I graduated from college in 1960 and got my master's degree in 1970, I should say, and then master's degree in 74. And back then, they still thought that it was bad parenting. There were studies about that. So there was, you know, not really any thought that it was something that could be cured. That's been totally debunked, thankfully. But that was, there wasn't much research on if it skipped a generation, but I tried to learn all I could. And now I think there's a rare book about mental illness that I haven't read. So there isn't any definitive answer, I don't think, as to why that is. But because it's only one in 100 people, you know, just because somebody in your family doesn't mean that it will be there even in the next generation or two. But the more relatives that have it, I always tell families,
the more those kids, the kids of those relatives and grandkids should not be using drugs because there is a correlation. I've certainly instructed my granddaughter, you are not to be using, don't even use marijuana. She lives in Washington, D.C., and they have legalized marijuana. I can smell it, you know, anytime we're walking down the street. When we used to be able to visit D.C., and she's pretty good about it. She knows.
Mindy, I have another question. Do you know how exercise can influence schizophrenia? I mean, we know that in other mental illnesses like depression, it can contribute or help with the symptoms. But how about schizophrenia, exercising, and so on?
I think exercise helps everybody, and including people with schizophrenia. You know, if you get out and get sunshine, you eat healthy, you exercise, just everybody does better, and certainly people with schizophrenia. And Jim is not very good about exercising. He's actually gained weight again because he's back on the medication that caused him to gain all that weight in those pictures I showed. And the more you don't get out and the more weight you gain, the more you don't want to exercise. So it's kind of a vicious cycle. But he always says he feels much better when he gets out and exercises.
So do they have any research regarding enhancement of exercise with some of the medications, or maybe try to compensate for some of the weight loss? I mean, weight gain that they have with the medications?
Well, the medications, when Jim was first on this really good med, it's called clozapine, no one told him he would gain weight. No one told us. He didn't even try to compensate for it with exercise. But now, nowadays, 20 years later, 15 years later, they tell people and they try to get them to exercise, and they have exercise classes. And so it's a much better, people are given a heads up, you know, on this weight gain. But the average person will gain like at least 30 pounds in very quick order. And but for Jim, he gains like 100 pounds on this medication, and he's not the only one. If you go to NAMI conferences, I've been to many state ones and a few national ones. Anytime you're there, you're going to see people that weigh, you know, 200, 300, 400 pounds, and you just figure they're on one of these meds, you know. One woman told me her sister, who was a beautiful woman, she was 5 feet and she gained 100 pounds, 5 feet tall, gained 100 pounds. And, so it's a trade-off, you know, that's the very best med is clozapine, and it causes the most weight gain. There are some older ones, like the ones my grandmother took, didn't cause weight gain, you know, the old fashioned medications. And some people are still on those. And they're pretty good, but they don't clean up the mind as well. So so then there are these other ones. So you have a choice. You know, you can have a better mind, or you can not gain weight and have a medium mind. It's a bad choice.
Are you aware of any brain imaging studies that have been done on schizophrenia?
I'm sorry?
Are you aware of any brain mapping studies that have been with schizophrenia?
Well, with the genome project, you know, that was the brain mapping, the big one that I think it was Bruce that asked about. And that one included schizophrenia, but all they were able to come up with was that many, many genes caused schizophrenia. So it didn't pinpoint anything. There is research going on, but not enough. Most of the research by the National Institute of Mental Health is on things like, right now, things like COVID, you know, and causing depression in people that are missing out on social activities. And of course, I'm biased, but I think schizophrenia should get to the head of the line on research, but it does not. But there are some places like the Stanley Research Foundation does research at Harvard, I think it is, on brain research, and they ask for people to donate their brains, and they actually study them. And there's some preliminary research coming out of there that that it could be related to like autoimmune diseases. So I'm always interested in that because our daughter has the autoimmune disease and our son has schizophrenia. So, you know, that's a small, too small of a sample to generalize from. But they're, that's the sort of thing that there really needs to be more of is, because I, you know, we figure we're going to have a vaccination soon, I hope, for COVID, and we whipped HIV, AIDS, and, you know, polio and other things. So if we would really put the money and the focus on serious mental illness, you know, we could, I think we could do something, but we just don't. It doesn't rise to the top. And I think part of that is because people don't talk about it. So thank you for having me here and talking.
This is Anita. I have a quick question. Do you find out, did your son experience where they start feeling better on the meds and they think, okay, I don't need it anymore? Because I have a friend whose brother was like that, and then he'd go off his meds and have episodes, and I was just curious.
Yes. Yeah. In fact, you know, when you saw that picture when I had Jim with me at the House of Representatives and he was sitting in my chair on the floor of the House, that was, he had done really well when he first started taking meds. And then he went off of them. He thought he was over it. You know, we all get done with anti or with different types of meds. You get 10 days of this or something, and you're very glad when you're done. You don't have to remember. You don't have any side effects. And those are not even side effects like gaining 100 pounds. So, of course, as soon as he was done taking them, he was no longer civilly committed, which he had to be to get him to take his meds at all the first time and other times. He just stopped. He thought he was doing well. And he actually ended up in jail in Montana because he got psychotic and broke a window. He often breaks glass when he's psychotic. For some reason, that relieves his tension. You've probably heard of people cutting themselves if they are in great mental distress. And Jim has not yet, but he breaks glass sometimes. And so he ended up in jail. I had to go and get him out. And then he had to go back on his meds. And we've had a lot of ups and downs with that. But for the last 15 years, he finally takes his meds. And he knows that he has to. And we're thankful that he does, because so many people with serious mental illness don't ever get insight to know they need their meds. So they often don't take them and then, of course, don't do well. Jim does know he needs his meds. He takes them. Our trouble with him, which now he's sober for over a year, but our trouble with him is always the drugs. And someone asked, you know, about the chicken and the egg. I think it was Myra, you know, which is, so he feels better if his meds aren't working very well. If he also supplements, he likes to use, still likes to use marijuana. So that's why he went back on the one that causes weight, because that one helps him not to use drugs because he feels better.
So I have a quick question, Mindy, about, you said you'd been in college, you would learn that, oh, it's a parenting thing. So clearly you were able to learn past that really quickly. How were you able to do that? Because a lot of people get stuck in that.
I know it. Well, I just knew I'd been a great parent. So I thought that couldn't possibly be it. Couldn't possibly. But I think a lot of people, you know, you always second guess yourself, though. You think, well, maybe I should have done that, or maybe I was too that. You know, I think it's very easy to get into that that thinking. And there are still plenty of people in the mental health system that encourage that thinking. You know, they think that all parents of people with serious mental illness must have done something or not done something. And so that you have to always fight against that. But I just, that never crossed my mind because I studied that when I was in college. So I thought, I'll just be a really good mom. I think I would have been anyway, because that's my nature. I love kids. But you know, you come across that. So the mental health system, one of the things that I wrote about in my book that's a common theme is communication with families. You know, there's so little communication, especially with people who are adults in the mental health system. They're better with children, but once a child turns 18, then you have to go through all this rigmarole to be able to communicate with people's providers. So if you think any of your children, anyone who has children, are coming down with a mental illness, act fast before they turn 18. But once they do, I think that, you know, it's easier not to communicate with others. You know, I was a teacher, so I know in the short term, it's easier if you just don't have to bother with extra people. But on the other hand, of course, it's better in the long term if you're communicating with teachers and families who can reinforce each other. And the same thing with the mental health system. There's a lot of research that shows families who are involved, their family member does better. But when you have a mental health system that thinks possibly the parents are at fault, then they're less apt to want to communicate with families. And that can feed upon itself. And then the family, you know, you wonder, why is it so many families with people with mental illness drop out and their family members are living on the streets or in the homeless camps or in the jails and prisons? And part of that is how they're treated, you know, by the mental health system and the person with mental illness. And then their confidence slacks and all of a sudden you've got a divorce with them.
And the families say, oh, kick them out. Kick them out. Well, that's how kids end up on the streets. If the family member, you know, like the parents are thinking, oh, it's my fault. And then they're getting this bad advice from other family members, you know, aunts, uncles, you know, grandparents saying,
exactly,
you know, kick them out of the house. It's like, well, that's not the answer. But,
you know, people, the difference between chemical dependency and mental illness, you know, the chemical dependency world, substance abuse, I guess we're supposed to say nowadays, they will, you know, the 12-step program, a lot of that is sink as low as you possibly can, and then you'll finally see the light, and then you can start climbing up the steps. That doesn't work for serious mental illness. You know, you'll never see the light. And so this kicking them out business is, and especially if it's teenagers, you know, I don't agree with that. I think it's unconscionable, actually. But so many people get impatient with the families, like you said, and encourage them to do that. And I think that is, you know, that's not helpful to anybody. And then the person with mental illness, if they're on the street, they will often, if their delusions tell them, they will commit a crime, you know, even if it's just break a window, like Jim started out with, then they end up in jail. You know, it's very hard to get in the mental health system. It's very easy to get into jail. And then you've got a record, you can't get an apartment, you can't get a job. I mean, it's just, it's a, you know, terrible syndrome.
Yeah, and
well, you know, one thing here is you mentioned that mental health, it's tough if the mental health people blame the parents. But we just had a little bit of conversation here, too, about blaming the parents if they throw the kid out. Got to remember, not everybody is capable of being able to cope year after. So my daughter has two autistic children, identical twins. They're both autistic. So my daughter's first 18 months is when it started showing up. So the first mode she went into is, I got to fix this. And then that led into, well, this is the fixing it is we have to change our lives around autistic children. Now, these two boys are now 9. And they couldn't be luckier to wind up with the two parents that they've got because they changed their lives and they revolve around, you know, two autistic children. But it is a stressful situation. And I don't know 9 years from now what it's going to be like, but it's, well, I don't need to talk to you, but it's got to be wearing. So the tolerance level for the family has to be extremely high to cope as these people turn 20, 30, 40, you know.
Exactly. And
not only coping with the person with the mental illness, but friends and family who don't understand, who berate them for not doing a better job. From the outside, it's so easy. It's just like, you know, that their fear of going to the grocery store, because if one of the kids decided that they were going to have a fit, and everybody around saying, "Well, just give them a good whack." That doesn't fix it. That doesn't change it. Just got to leave the store.
Yeah, whack might really put things out of control. You know, autism is, as you know, on a spectrum, as you know, and people at the high end of the spectrum, the higher functioning, are like people with mental illness, and the people at the lower end are like people with developmental disabilities. So across the street from us, we have a family with two children with autism as well. And the mother used to work at the Autism Society. So they're very sophisticated. Their kids had PCAs, both of them, from the time they were diagnosed. The first one about 18 months, the second one even earlier, because by then they were sophisticated. The doctor had told them, once you have a child with autism, your chances of getting a second one are slim to nil. Well, that was very wrong. You know, once you have one, yeah, very good chances of getting another one. So the doctor gave them erroneous information. But now, their children are very similar to our son because they're high functioning. And so then they look perfectly normal. Most of the time they act perfectly normal. But when they get set off, you know, they'll totally have a meltdown. And then nobody understands, you know, what. And then they just also, you know, have a hard time. And then when they're young, they easily get set off by almost anything if their routines aren't followed. And so it's a very hard thing. And that's the fear of all parents. You know, when you've got young children, you just day-to-day cope, and teenagers and young adults. But once the kids are grown up and the parents start getting older, that's the fear of everybody. What are we going to do now? And these two children across the street, I call them children, but they're actually both about, you know, 28 and 30 now. They are still living at home because their mother and father, especially their mother, who, you know, got very active in the movement, has checked out group homes, has checked out everything under the sun, and she's not satisfied with anything else compared to how they are doing living at home. And they're both working full time. The son has a car that he drives to the park and ride and back. That's as much as driving as he does. But they're doing so well because they had so much help when they were, you know, just infants or toddlers, and because of their parents. And so they don't see how they could do that well anywhere else, but yet they're getting older. So it's a big concern.
Well, thank you, Mindy, so much for joining us. If a few people want to stay on here after the meeting and talk a little bit more.
I'd like the name of your book again.
Fix What You Can. Here it is. Fix What You Can, Schizophrenia and a Lawmaker's Fight for Her Son. And I do have a lot in there about the legislature, but I just, you know, in the interest of time, I didn't bother to talk about it. But for people who are interested in advocacy, that's another reason I wrote the book, so you could learn how to advocate, how to work with elected officials. But it's a story. I wanted it to be a story because I thought nobody's going to want to read facts and figures, like a good story that's a page turner.
Thank you, Mindy.
Well, thank you so much, Mindy. This was a very important topic, and thank you for sharing your story about your son and your family. Appreciate it. Our inspirational quote for today is, as we express our gratitude, we must never forget that the highest appreciation is not to utter words, but to live by them. And that's from John F. Kennedy. And so with that, we'll adjourn, and everybody have a fantastic weekend and get out and enjoy that weather while they can. And like I said, I'll stay on for a little bit longer if anybody wants to talk to Mindy a little bit more, but Have a great weekend. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Mindy.
Thank you, Mindy.
Thank you.
Thank you.